Hello everyone, welcome to MBBS classes. Myself Dr. Hanifa. Today in this video I'll be talking on allergic rhinitis. Allergic rhinitis, it is a symptomatic disorder of the nose induced by immunoglobulin E mediated inflammation due to the exposure to the foreign substances referred as allergens. The classical symptoms of this disease are nasal itching, sneezing, rhinorrhea and the nasal congestion. If we see the epidemiology of allergic rhinitis, it is one of the most common diseases globally. And it is estimated that more than 20% of the world population suffers from IgE-mediated allergic diseases. It is seen that allergic rhinitis is found to be associated frequently with the asthma, and around 50 to 40% of the patients, they have allergic rhinitis and the asthma together. The reason is nowadays because the pathophysiology of both these diseases is similar, and that is why it is called one airway, one disease. If you see the age group, the prevalence of the seasonal allergic rhinitis is higher in children and the adolescents than in adults. And this seasonal rhinitis, it rarely occurs in children younger than the 2 years of age, because the individual, they need low dose exposure to the allergens over the period of many years before the development of symptoms. So the disease is affecting these children and the adolescent group, and the studies have found that this allergic rhinitis is causing a variety of problems in this group of patients. It is affecting their quality of life, such as learning impairment, inability to integrate with their peer groups. And if you see the gender distribution, this disease, it affects the males and the females equally. There are certain risk factors which are found to be associated with the disease. And the studies have found that the three risk factors are important. The first being the genetic and the family history. Second risk factor is the early life exposures. And third is nowadays pollution is also considered as one of the risk factors for the development of the disease. Now let's see the role of genetics and the family history in allergic rhinitis. It is seen that if a patient is having a family history of allergic rhinitis, it increases the odds of having a disease in a child. If neither of the parent is atopic, then the chances of atopy in children is still 10%. And when one of the parent is atopic, or if one sibling is atopic, then the chances of atopy increases to 20 to 30%. And when both the parents are atopic, then the chances of atopy is about 40 to 50% in the children. So now what is atopy? Atopy is the predisposition to respond to the environmental allergens with the production of specific immunoglobulin E antibody. It is seen that if one child or one patient is having a history of bronchial asthma, in that case, there is more likely to develop allergic rhinitis, and the risk of getting the disease is 4 to 6 times greater than the general population. Nowadays, the genetics, the role is linked to the chromosome 5qCD14 gene. And moreover, the studies have found that the concordance of allergic rhinitis in identical twin is found to be higher than in the fraternal twins. So there is definitely a hereditary transmission of the disease which is being strongly associated. Now the second risk factor, which is the early life exposure. So to explain well this risk factor, a hypothesis is being proposed, which is called the hygiene hypothesis. So according to the hygiene hypothesis, the infections in the early life, they protect from the development of allergic diseases in the later part of the life. So this is very interesting. So according to this hypothesis, allergic diseases and the infection, they have an inverse relationship. And the supporting evidences are from the studies which have shown that there is a rising trend of the allergic diseases in developed countries. It is found more in the individuals brought up in smaller and the wealthier families. And in developing nations too, the disease is more in the urban population than in the rural population. So what is happening in these three sets of patients? The children, they are brought up in the families with the improved conditions, smaller family size, better hygiene. So these group of patients, they are not being exposed to the infections in the early life. And this hypothesis is proposing that since they are not exposed to the infections in the early life, they are prone to develop allergic diseases in the later part of the life. So we know that our immune system, it responds by producing the inflammatory mediators. So to explain the hygiene hypothesis, this figure is given. So if you see here, if a child is exposed to the childhood infections, so in that case, the T helper 1 set of the cells are stimulated and it leads to the production of cytokines, interferon gamma and the interleukin 2. This is the cell mediated response. On the other way around, if the child is exposed to indoor allergens or good socioeconomic condition, small family size, in that case, the different set of cytokines are produced by the T helper cell 2 chains. And it is studies have found that the cytokines which are produced in the T helper 1 chain and the T helper 2 chain, they inhibit the expressions of the counterpart. So if a child is exposed to the childhood infections, then this cell mediated responses will be activated and this will have a inhibitory response on the T helper 2 cells. The third risk factor is pollution, and role and the impact of pollution on the allergic rhinitis is still, it remains controversial. The pollutants may be indoors and outdoors. Like outdoor pollutants like nitrogen dioxide, sulfur dioxide, and the indoor pollutants like cigarette smoke. And studies have found that the pollutants, it increases the nasal responsiveness to the environmental allergens. So we are getting the term allergens. So allergens are the foreign substances which are capable of provoking an IgE mediated response. The size of allergens may vary from 5 to 20 microns. And again, the allergens are of two types, indoor and outdoor. It is seen that the outdoor allergens, they are found to be associated more with the seasonal allergic rhinitis, and the indoor allergens, they are associated more commonly with the perennial rhinitis. We'll come to the individual rhinitis in the subsequent slides. So the examples of the outdoor allergens being like pollens from the trees, plants, weeds and grasses. And so since they are seasonal, so they are most commonly associated with the seasonal allergic rhinitis. And the second group is the mold and the fungi. Among the indoor allergens, it can be from the animals, like animal danders, from any pet dogs, cat, or from the mice. Then dust mites, it is a major allergen, that is the house dust. And the source being the beddings, carpets, it can be anything, stuffed toys. Then another important indoor allergen is cockroaches, molds. It could be the allergens at workplace like paint and plastic industries. And in healthcare workers, the important allergen is the latex from the powdered gloves. Now let us come to the pathophysiology of allergic rhinitis. So to better understand the pathophysiology, it is divided into different subcategories. It is the sensitization and the immunoglobulin E production. Then is the early allergic response. We will also see about the neuronal contribution to the allergic rhinitis. Then late response to the antigens, a series of cellular events and adhesion molecules, recruitment and the hyper-responsiveness. So this is a complete diagram which describes about the pathophysiology of allergic rhinitis. The first stage is the phase of processing of the antigen and the production of the specific IgE antibodies. Let's see how it happens. On exposure to the allergen, so here the allergen is, you can also say as the antigen. So on exposure to the allergen, when it gets deposited on the nasal mucosa, it gets engulfed by these antigen presenting cells. So the antigen presenting cells, it could be macrophages, dendritic cells, Langerhans cells. When this allergen, it is taken up by the antigen presenting cells, this allergen, it gets partially degraded inside the antigen presenting cells. by the phagolysosomes. And what happens after that is that after the processing of these allergens, a part of the allergen gets exteriorized. That means on the antigen presenting cells, a part of the processed allergen, it comes on the exterior surface of the antigen presenting cells. Then these antigen presenting cells is recognized by the CD4 T cells. These CD4 T cells then they secrete the cytokines like interleukin 4, interleukin 5 and 13, and these cytokines they stimulate the plasma cells to form the IgE antibodies. Moreover, these CD4 T cells they also help in the recruitment of the eosinophils at the site of the allergic reactions. So you can see it is a chain: allergen coming to the antigen presenting cells, the antigen presenting cell is processing the antigen, then it gets recognized by the CD4 T cells. The CD4 T cells they release cytokines. These cytokines then they stimulate the B and the plasma cells, and ultimately the specific Ig antibody is produced. Then is the next phase comes, that is the early allergic response. Then what happens is that these Ig antibodies, whatever are produced, they get attached to the mast cells and the basophils. Then on re-exposure to the allergens or the antigens, when these allergens in contact with these IgE antibodies, now this IgE antibody is a receptor. Then the cross-linking occurs between the allergen and the IgE antibody, and it leads to the release of the mediators. These mediators may be preformed mediators and some are newly formed mediators. So the mediators which are released from the mast cells are and the basophils are histamines, prostaglandin D2, leukotriene B4 and leukotriene C4. So when the mediator is released, then it stimulates the blood vessels, nerves and the glands, and the stimulation of these mediators only, it leads to the clinical symptoms of the allergic rhinitis like sneezing, runny nose, itching and the nasal obstruction. In the pathophysiology, we have seen that there is a role of the cellular cascade. So what is the cellular events? It is seen that there is a recruitment of the inflammatory cell to the nasal mucosa. So the cells like eosinophils, basophils, monocytes and lymphocytes, they come to the site, and it results in a state of chronic inflammation, and this makes the person hyper responsive to the specific and the non-specific stimuli. So this is called priming of the nasal mucosa, and this hyper responsiveness is the hallmark of the disease. So this is a flow chart showing the sensitization on the immunoglobulin E production. So we have seen antigen getting deposited, then it is getting processed, getting recognized by the CD4 true cells. Then they secrete cytokines. The cytokines, they help in the production of IgE and in the recruitment of eosinophil at the site of allergic reactions. Then the allergic responses also we have seen on subsequent exposure to the offending allergens. The Ig antibody which are present on the surface of these mast cells, they get attached to the allergens. The cross-linking occurs, and which leads to the release of inflammatory mediators, which stimulates the nerve, glands and the blood vessels. And when it leads to the clinical manifestations, this event is called the early allergic response. The role of neuronal contribution is also being considered in the pathophysiology, because the supporting facts are the nasal response to the allergen is also accompanied by ocular, pulmonary and even a sinus response. That means it is not only the nasal symptoms, the patient sometimes may have ocular and the pulmonary symptoms also. So this is explained by the neural reflex, which definitely involves the nervous system. Then it is other supporting fact for the neuronal contribution is that the ocular symptoms are found to be initiated by the action of histamine on the nasal afferent nerves that initiates the nasal ocular reflex. Moreover, Several neuropeptides, in addition to the sympathetic and the parasympathetic nerves, are found in the nasal mucosa, and these neuropeptides are secreted by the unmyelinated nociceptive C fibers. So these are the supporting facts which suggest a definite role of the nervous system in the pathophysiology of allergic rhinitis. Now, there is some late response to the antigens. So this late response to the antigen explains the recurrence of the symptoms hours after the antigen challenge is done. Like the late response, most notably is the nasal congestion. So again, let's see the supporting facts. It is seen that there is an elevation in the nasal airway resistance at around 4 to 10 hours after the antigen challenge is done. And there is a rise in the titers of the certain mediators like interleukin 1 beta, then TNF alpha and GM-CSF were also detected during the early hours after the provocation, and other group of mediators are found in the late phase response. So we have seen that there is an inflammatory cellular influx in the nasal mucosa, and the type of the cells are a little bit different in the nasal secretions and in the nasal mucosa. In nasal secretions, the polymorphonuclear cells and the eosinophils, they predominate, whereas it is seen that in the nasal mucosa, the mononuclear cells, they predominate. Another important event in the pathophysiology is the hyperresponsiveness. It is seen that many allergic patients, they complain of worsening of the symptoms as the allergy season progresses, despite of unchanged or the decreased pollen counts. So the answer to this is the hyperresponsiveness. And the hyperresponsiveness, it is a hallmark of the allergic rhinitis. It is caused by a shift in the threshold of the responsiveness, and it occurs due to the priming phenomena. The priming, it is seen that it occurs as a result of cellular infiltration, which we have seen, due to the mediator release and due to the end organ response. And altogether, what they do is they alter the mucosal reaction or to the allergen, and they increase the again the mediator production. So whatever cascade of event is happening, it is priming the nasal mucosa, and it makes the person susceptible to the symptoms even when the amount of allergen is less in the environment. Now let's see the classification of allergic rhinitis. So the allergic rhinitis may be classified based on the time of occurrence. It may be seasonal when it occurs in one particular season, and it could be perennial when the symptoms are present throughout the year. But nowadays, most commonly, we classify the allergic rhinitis as whether the symptoms are intermittent or persistent. Again, there is a subgrading whether the symptoms are mild, moderate, and severe. To administer the treatment, we follow the second classification, that is intermittent, persistent, and it is designed to guide treatment of the disease. Now, let's see the classification of allergic rhinitis according to the area guidelines. So what the intermittent means? Intermittent means the symptoms are present less than 4 days a week or less than 4 weeks. Persistent means when the symptoms are present more than 4 days a week or and more than 4 weeks. The symptoms are called mild when the symptoms are present, like runny nose, itching, sneezing, but none of the following is present. So mild means when there is no sleep disturbance, when there is no impairment of daily activities, when there is no impairment of school work, or when there is no troublesome disturbances. But it is called moderate to severe when one or more of the following is present, like sleep disturbance, impairment of daily activities, school and work. If any one of these is present, then it is labeled as moderate to severe. So while taking the history only, we can classify the type of the allergic rhinitis and the grading of the disease. So the classical symptom of allergic rhinitis, we know it is nasal itching, sneezing, rhinorrhea, and nasal congestion. But some of the patients, they may have an additional ocular symptoms like itching, redness of the eyes, and tearing. Some patients may also have the itching of the palate, post-nasal drip, and also cough. So whenever we are taking history of the patient, a case of allergic rhinitis, always try to take a correlation of the exposure to the allergens with the occurrence of the symptoms. Then take a history of any prior therapy, presence or absence of asthma. Then take a good family history in the parents, in the siblings, for the treatment purpose to rule out pregnancy, and take a detailed drug history of the patient. So whenever we are examining the patient suspected to be a case of allergic rhinitis, a complete ear, nose, throat examination is essential in the workup. So when we are examining a patient, when we look at the face of the patient, the classically, some of the patients, they may have a classical feature or called the allergic faces. So the components of the allergic faces is the patient will have a mouth breathing because of the chronic nasal obstruction. Then in some, we may also get allergic shiners. So this allergic shiners, it is the puffiness of the eyelids and the periorbital cyanosis, which occurs due to the venous stasis developing secondary to the chronic nasal obstruction. Another third component of the allergic faces is the allergic solute, where you will get a transverse supratip nasal crease at the junction of the upper and the lower lateral cartilages, which occurs due to the continuous rubbing of the nose. So we must do the nasal examination, especially the endoscopic examination. Note down the consistency of the nasal discharge, whether it is thin, clear, or whitish. Note down the color of the nasal mucosa or the presence or the absence of the polyp. Also examine the eyes and look for any redness, injections of the conjunctiva, or any swelling of the eyelids. So for diagnosis of the allergic rhinitis, identification of the allergen which is responsible for the patient symptom is most important for establishing the diagnosis also, and for advising the patient to avoid the allergen. So the two sets of tests to identify the allergens are available. One is in vivo test, which is the skin prick test, and the other one is the in vitro test, that is the serum IgE measurement. So in the skin prick test, it is a method of demonstrating the sensitivity to a given allergen. And after this test, it evaluates the presence of specific IgE antibodies on the skin mast cells. The methodology is that a small drop of concentrated allergen is introduced into the dermis of the patient. The sites which are chosen, they are most commonly the volar aspect of the forearm and the, or it may be the back. And after the administration of these allergens, a positive response is identified by the presence or of the wheal and the flare within the period of 10 to 15 minutes. The advantage of the skin prick test is that the costing is low, it has a great sensitivity, and the result we get rapidly. But the disadvantages is being it is not suitable for patients with other dermatological diseases. Then the patient, they have low tolerance because of the multiple pricks to identify the allergens. There is a possibility of systemic reaction. And the last is that we need to maintain the potency of the allergen extracts. So to overcome the shortcomings of the in vivo skin prick test, in vitro serum IgE measurement can also be done. It is also useful in the diagnosis of allergic rhinitis. The advantage is that definitely it eliminates the need of multiple skin pricks. But the disadvantage being it is expensive and it takes longer period of time. So just to share with you, this is one of the samples of the test of the IgE measurement, where the blood test is done and you can see that the IgE is measured for the individual allergens. It could be food particles, it could be, the most common is the, you can see here, dermatophagoids, this is the dust mite. Other supporting investigations For the allergic rhinitis, we may also get peripheral eosinophilia. It is non-specific. It just indicates the presence of atopic diseases. Then if we do the cytological examination of the nasal mucosa swab, then identification of eosinophils may help us in differentiating it from the infectious causes. Radiology don't have a much role in the allergic rhinitis, but in children, X-ray nasopharynx could be done to see the adenoid size, and CT scan can be advised to rule out the sinusitis. Then pulmonary function test, if a patient is having any other diseases like asthma or any suspected history case of cystic fibrosis, then you have to advise pulmonary function test. Now let's come to the treatment of the allergic rhinitis. So the treatment begins with the avoidance or teaching the patient to avoid the allergens. And the measures are targeted mainly towards the indoor allergens, especially the dust mites. Because avoiding the offending allergens is potentially an effective method for the allergic rhinitis. So there are certain advice which must be given to the patients, like removing a pet from the house, covering the pillows and the mattresses, regular washing of the bedding with the hot water, vacuuming the mattresses and the pillows. And it is seen that by following these measures, it helps in reducing the burden of the allergens indoors. And we can take a control of the indoor allergens, but outdoor allergens like grasses, weeds are more difficult to control. Now let's see the pharmacotherapy in the allergic rhinitis. So the different subcategories of the medicines which are prescribed, it could be antihistaminics, decongestants, intranasal steroids, systemic steroids, leukotriene modifiers, immunotherapy, IgE antibodies, and the treatment of the eye symptoms. Antihistaminics, the H1 antihistaminics, they block the histamines at the H1 receptor level. Antihistamines are the most commonly prescribed medicine for the allergic rhinitis, and H1 antihistamines can be given orally, and they are also available as an intranasal spray. They are declassified into first generation, that is the sedating, and the second generation group of drugs. The first generation H1 antihistamines are the diphenhydramine, and the second generation is the loratadine, cetirizine, desloratadine, fexofenadine, and levocetirizine. The intranasal form of H1 antihistamine which is available is the azelastin nasal spray and the olopatadine nasal spray. The second group of drug which is given in the allergic rhinitis is the decongestants. The decongestants, they are available both in the oral and the topical forms. These decongestants, they act on alpha-1 and alpha-2 adrenergic receptors which are present on the resistance vessels. They act by alpha adrenergic stimulation. The oral decongestants which are used are the pseudoephedrine and the phenylephrine, but they should be avoided in hypertensives and in the patients with the coronary artery disease. The topical decongestants which are occasionally given in a case of allergic rhinitis are the oxymetazoline and the xylometazoline. The topical are more helpful during the acute exacerbation. They are found to be more efficacious than the systemic decongestants as they do not have any systemic side effects. The third group of drugs which is given in the allergic rhinitis are the leukotriene modifiers. We have seen that the leukotrienes, they are generated in the allergic rhinitis, and so the inhibitors of the 5-lipoxygenase pathway, xylutin, and the leukotriene receptor antagonist are used for the treatment of the allergic rhinitis. And out of these, the leukotriene receptor antagonist is most commonly used, like montelukast and zafirlukast. The most commonly used medicine for allergic rhinitis is the montelukast. It is equally effective as antihistaminics for the control of nasal and the ocular symptoms. Then intranasal steroids are the most potent drugs which are available for allergic rhinitis due to their diverse anti-inflammatory effects. Intranasal steroid is regarded as the first line treatment for the allergic rhinitis. It is found to reduce the antigen induced hyperresponsiveness of the nasal mucosa to the subsequent antigen. Moreover, these intranasal steroids, they are also found to inhibit the influx of the inflammatory cells. So the recommendation is, in cases of mild allergic rhinitis, the intranasal steroid is given as needed, whereas in moderate to severe, they are recommended to use the intranasal steroid regularly. Next is when to use the systemic steroids. The use of systemic steroid in allergic rhinitis is limited because of its side effects and because the limited morbidity of the disease itself. But sometimes in some of the patients who are in the middle of the pollen season or the seasonal allergic rhinitis, those who are having a total nasal obstruction, sometimes it could be given for a shorter duration of time. Immunotherapy is again another therapy which is given for the allergic rhinitis. The allergen-specific immunotherapy, it involves the repeated administration by sublingual or subcutaneous means of increasing dose of the antigen extract in an attempt to alter the patient's immunological response and to improve their symptoms. So the indications where the immunotherapy is given for the patients who find difficulty in avoiding the allergens, first of all. Second thing, when the patient is not getting adequate response to the pharmacological therapy, and when the patient is having significant perennial disease throughout the year with no response to the maximal medical treatment. So the immunotherapy can be considered for these three group of patients. Nowadays, the role of anti-IgE is also being trialed. The recombinant humanized monoclonal anti-IgE antibodies forms the complex with the free IgE and it blocks its interaction with the mast cells and the basophils. But it is ill-suited as the mainstay of treatment for the allergic rhinitis because of its cost-effectiveness and because of its inconvenient route of administration, which is the subcutaneous route. Now, since the patient of allergic rhinitis, they have the ocular symptoms also. So to treat the eye symptoms, the two group of medicines are found to be effective, the oral antihistamines and the leukotriene receptor antagonists. They are effective in controlling the eye symptoms. The antihistamines are also available as the eye drops and they are given intraocularly, and it is also found to be effective for the control of the allergic eye symptoms. So the drug which is available as the eye drop is the olopatadine. It is effective because of its rapid onset of action, because of its lower rates of sedation and the dry eye. So this is the treatment guidelines as per the area guidelines. So you can see here for the treatment of the allergic rhinitis, first of all, the disease is divided into mild, moderate, severe, and intermittent and persistent. So if a patient is having mild and intermittent, then the treatment which is advised is the oral antihistaminics or intranasal antihistamines, which is given. It can be added with the decongestants or leukotriene antagonist, or add intraocular antihistamines whenever required. Then for the moderate to severe intermittent type of allergic rhinitis, the treatment protocol is, we can give the oral antihistamines or intranasal antihistamines. It can be added with the decongestants, or we can also add here the intranasal corticosteroids. And the patients, they are asked to review after a gap of 2 to 4 weeks. If the patient improves, then it is continued for a period of another month. And if it is not improved, then they are treated as severe condition. When a patient is having mild persistent type of symptoms, in that case, it is recommended to give oral antihistaminics or intranasal antihistaminics, and they can be added with the decongestants or intranasal steroids or the leukotriene receptor antagonist. If a patient is having moderate to severe persistent type, then the preferred order is we have to give a trial with the intranasal corticosteroid first. And along with that, we can also add oral antihistaminics or leukotriene receptor antibodies. And in all these three subcategories, if it is not improved, then we have to consider the immunotherapy for the patient. If the patient belongs to some special groups, like if in cases of pregnancy, the intranasal steroid of choice is the budesonide. In the elderly, always remember, avoid the sedating antihistamines. In athletes, avoid systemic decongestants. And if a patient is on antiretroviral therapy, avoid intranasal steroids. With this, I come to an end of this video. Thank you for watching this video.